our witnesses for coming in and for very illuminating submissions to the committee. Can I ask Cora first, are you not effectively saying in what you just said there that we're being blackmailed or held hostage by multinationals and that really we have no choice but to just submit to that? And do you really think that that's a reasonable or sustainable way for an economy to operate, where out of fear that multinationals will up sticks and leave, we've got to tread softly in terms of how we treat them and ensuring that they pay a reasonable contribution towards the state and the society that facilitates them making so many profits? I mean, is that not in nice language what you're saying is that we've got to accept the blackmail because the multinationals are essentially blackmailing us?
I think a good example of where this has happened before, you know, when you're... There's part of tax policy and tax law that's referred to as behavioural economics. And it tries to foresee, you know, if you do one thing, what, you know, how will people react to it, whether they're individuals or whether they're companies. Changing the rules can have consequences. And that's, I suppose, that happens. In the UK recently, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, they raised the marginal tax rate to 50p, just the income tax, not including their national insurance. And there were estimates done in the UK about how much you know, this was going to raise for the UK exchequer. And the difficulty was that after a year or two, it hadn't raised that much because of the behavioural change that happened with the people that it was targeted at.
No, I think you've made that point and you've made it very well. But to translate all that into layman's language, doesn't that just mean, in technical language, we're submitting to blackmail?
Well,
out of fear that they'll leg it if we try and force them to make a slightly greater contribution to our economy. And I'm asking, you know, is that not really what's going on? And is not submitting also in that way really being part of a race to the bottom? Because you've acknowledged, and I think it's quite important, and indeed Deputy McGrath, who's a great supporter of the corporate tax regime here, which I'm not, I can tell you, is saying that investment is already beginning to migrate elsewhere because other places are joining in the race to the bottom for corporate tax. So even if we get down on our knees and submit to the multinationals, as I would assert we have, they still go elsewhere because everybody else just races to get down on their knees even further. Does that know what's happening?
I understand what you're saying. I think the best way to address that is through the framework of the rules that are there and making sure that the rules that are there deal with the challenges, because it's very hard to change the behaviour of people. So I think the best thing that you can do is participate in making sure that the rules and the law and the regime is allocating profits to places where substance and activity is taking place. And by doing that, you know, if those are the international rules, then the multinationals have got to operate within those rules, you know, and there is more, if you like, of a level playing field. And you know, that's probably the way to tackle it rather than trying to tackle it on your own.
Isn't that a little bit like, you know, to make an analogy between the argument about nuclear disarmament? We are all in favour of nuclear disarmament, but we'll get involved in a long process of negotiating nuclear disarmament. But meantime, we better build as many nuclear weapons as we can. isn't that actually what's happening? So we're talking about getting a new international framework, but in reality, what's actually happening is there's a race to the bottom in terms of corporate tax to the advantage of the multinationals.
you know, this is an urgent project that is happening. It's not something that is kind of being pushed way out into the future. You know, this has a deadline of the end of next year, which for something of that scale is kind of unprecedented. Nothing this big has ever been done so quickly before. So, you know, I know what you're saying, but, you know, this is urgent and this is being dealt with by the G8 and the G20 and the OECD. And, you know, it's probably better to kind of deal with it systemically and try and fix it and put our efforts into that.
I mean, I'll just say I'm not as optimistic as you. I think the G8 were dealing with global poverty and inequality about 10 or 15 years ago. We haven't had much movement on that front. But, you know, I fair play to you for your optimism. But can I just move to Dr. Professor Stewart? And I just want to say I want to commend you on challenging the consensus, really, in this area. I mean, I think what you've said today is hugely important, and it runs counter to really everything that is being asserted by mainstream commentators, and I would say the government and the political establishment in this country, because they're saying there's really nothing to see here in terms of, you know, low effective rates. But you're saying there is, and I just really want to pin this down. What you're saying, if you could just confirm it, is that the general rule for allocating profits in Ireland and internationally is that if you're incorporated in a particular place, you pay tax in a particular place. But this does not apply in Ireland in relation to multinationals.
Yeah,
if you're that somehow there's a more favourable regime for them, and this is quite key in how they are avoiding paying tax.
It's a different regime. It should not be more favourable, but it's a different regime. That's just tax law. That's in the Revenue Commissioner guidelines. That's where you're incorporated is where you pay tax. And can I just comment on Cora's answer earlier on? I think one of the problems is that we've a tax-driven industrial policy. And that creates then, if we've a problem with our tax system, then we go to the tax experts to try to solve it. And some people will regard these tax experts as the tax avoidance industry. So how can we really ensure that they will come up with solutions to the tax problem that are actually in the general interest of everybody and not in the interest of their clients? For after all, the people that the Department of Finance are calling in, the Big Four had, I think in 2011, $25 billion in revenues from tax advice. They're not disinterested persons. They have a particular vested interest in the whole tax regime and perhaps in complexity in advising clients or whatever.
So in other words, you're saying the people who are giving the Department of Finance advice in this area are people who actually have a vested interest in an interpretation?
Of course they have, because the department launches its BES, base erosion and profit switching strategy. It says that it has basically invited various people in, including I think yourselves were invited in to talk to them.
It's a public consultation.
It's a public consultation that you're basically you're going to be invited in, and in the Big Four. So it says here, I have it here, it says that we've organised through IBEC, the Irish Taxation Institute, the American Chamber of Commerce and Chartered Accountants Ireland. And consultations have also taken place with civil society organisations. So there's a public consultation process. But the people best informed to shape this consultation process are, of course, the big accounting firms, because they have the expertise. So it's all right very well for the Department of Finance or the Revenue to say, well, anybody can get one of these advanced rulings. It's a bit like what people have said about the law, that the law is like the Ritz, it's free to walk in. But how can anybody else, unless you have a lot of wealth behind you, afford to actually get a tax ruling and get a lobby and get all sorts of other things? So I think the answer really is that it's our tax-based industrial policy, and I think we need to move away from that. We need to emphasise indigenous firms. We need to focus on the things that really matter. New products, quality improvement, logistics, supply chain management, marketing. These are the things that will really lead to long-run economic success. Tax policy will lead to tax-induced behaviour. So if you introduce a tax concession, then there's an incentive to minimise your tax, to try to fit one activity into that. So when we had the manufacturing tax, there's a constant struggle to widen this so that grain drying became manufacturing, all sorts of other things, bagging coal, whatever, all these things became manufacturing. It's a problem with a tax-driven driven industrial strategy, and it's a mindset as well. If we have a problem, we say, well, change the tax. That's, we have a problem with innovation, we have a problem, yeah, change the tax. We have a problem with some other, introduce a tax concession.
Well, three cheers for that perspective. And I couldn't agree with you more. Just on the, you know, we're making comparisons with, if you like, one law really for domestic industry and companies, and another law for these multinationals in the area of, you know, tax liability. Can I also just ask, in terms of the, do you think this also applies to the taxes that are registered in Ireland? You know, the ones that are on the CT21 table, or whatever it's called, the finance department's tables, where it shows 70 billion pre-tax profits and 4 billion actually paid in tax. Now, there's some debate about the effective rate, how it applies to this as well, and should the effective rate be as I would calculate it, which is you take your gross profits, you take your tax paid, and you see what one is as a proportion of the other, and you get an effective rate of 6.4, I think, whereas others maintain that actually it's much closer to 12.5, because there's all these deductions and allowances and so on. What would your view of comparing that with how you treat the ordinary PAYE income taxpayer? Do you know what I mean? Is the way the effective rate is calculated much more favourable for companies in that regard than it is for your ordinary taxpayer, who doesn't get a whole load of allowances and deductions and write-offs before we decide what's liable for tax?
I think one problem with our tax system is its complexity. That if you were in business, certainly you would have to get tax advice and pay for tax advice. Now, because of this complexity, then if you hire really expert people and they charge a lot, you will be able to use allowances. It's perfectly legal in a way that if you don't have that expertise, you would not be able to use. So if you like, the tax system becomes, the tax you pay becomes partly a function of the tax advice you get. Now, in some cases, there's no wiggle room at all. You have to pay the tax. But in other cases, there may be considerable wiggle room as to what you can actually do and getting a favourable ruling as to what's acceptable and what is not acceptable. So that it is the interests of the tax advisors to think about things and to spend a lot of effort into working out how to minimise tax payments. So they're very innovative in this way, and there are considerable incentives for tax advisors to behave in this way. And unfortunately, yeah.
So if you can afford, which few can, to hire high powered accountants and tax experts to minimise your tax liability, you can do very well.
There's a better probability, yeah, should we say, yeah, of minimising your tax liability than if you don't do that, that's, yeah, for sure.
Just one, to bring these two different sort of elements together, which is, I think, an important crossover between what is declared and what isn't liable because it's not resident, is the whole issue of the monies paid over as administrative expenses to the shelf companies for use of patents and software and all that kind of stuff. I mean, just in terms of tackling that, right, can you just give us your opinion on that? Because, I mean, obviously if the law was very straightforward, but you seem to be saying it is most of the time, which is if you're incorporated here, you're liable here, and those, all that would be allocated here. Is it up without legislation? Could the revenue just look at the rules differently? I mean, because it seems to me, from what you're saying, is any reasonable person looking at the companies that we're talking about would say, come off it, this money isn't being made in Bahamas or the Cayman Islands. Insofar as you could allocate it anywhere, it should be here. And that within the existing rules, they should in fact be allocating those profits to Ireland. I mean, is that not what any reasonable person...
I think, and one perhaps solution would be to introduce a withholding tax. And you may have been familiar with the strategy called the Dutch sandwich. And the Dutch sandwich, where profits were routed to a Netherlands-based company, was designed to get around that withholding tax for royalty payments from Ireland. Now, subsequently, the revenue issued a directive saying that royalty payments do not have to be withheld from payments from Ireland. So I think there is, but then withholding taxes can create their own difficulties, and there may be tax treaties which may be very difficult to introduce withholding taxes. But it's an area that could be examined in relation to raising tax revenue, and perhaps that might be an option.
Very finally, I'm probably out of time, but just to cut a long story short, on the whole issue of effective rate, there's been a very heated debate about what is the effective rate. But in your opinion, as a professor and expert in this area, you think that the effective rate, more reasonably calculated and looked at, is closer to the 2% that has been alleged than the 11.9% being claimed by the government?
Yeah, I certainly think so for US companies. But we have to remember that if we looked at, as I said in my introduction, if we looked at a distribution of tax statistics, we would find very varying amounts. Some people paying quite a lot of tax, and there are companies who do actually pay 12.5% in actual cash tax payments. So there's quite a spectrum, but I would say it's reasonable, because we have to remember that the aggregate data is dominated by the very big firms, and we know that one of those firms had 0.5% rate of tax. So if you factor that in, that's a huge whack of multinational companies' profits in Ireland, and they're paying 0.5%. So other companies, if they're paying a bit over their 3 or 4%, that will average out to about 0.5%. 2%.
Could I ask, Mr. Bryan, just, because that's quite a different view from the one you've articulated. I mean, what do you say to that, that really a reasonable assessment of the effective rate would actually put it closer? Because the normal rule is, if you're incorporated in a place, you're taxed there. And while you can interpret it as the government and the Department of Finance are doing, if you were being consistent, you wouldn't.
I'm just applying the law as it stands, Deputy, and the law as it stands says that if you're not resident, you cannot be taxed on profits that are not attributable to Ireland.
But do you think the way in which we're defining residency is reasonable?
I think it is. It is the way that residence is defined right across the world, and the US is exceptional. The US has an incorporation test which basically says that worldwide income, if you're incorporated in the US, you're subject to worldwide income, and then there are their tax deferral rules. But the general consensus of all countries and the OECD is that management and control is the test which determines where you are resident.
Do you believe that these companies that we're talking about are managed and controlled from the Cayman Islands? Do you seriously believe that?
That is a question of fact. It's the facts and circumstances.
You actually believe that companies, in the case of one of the ones that is at the centre of much discussion at the weekend, it was discovered it doesn't even have offices in the alleged place. It doesn't even have offices. But you think it's a reasonable proposition to suggest that a company that doesn't have offices in a place is actually managed and controlled from that place?
It doesn't really matter what I believe. That is the case. That's the case law, and that's the legislation that's there.
Thank you, Deputy. Just a few quick questions, if you don't mind, myself.